The second key to take the old stone cake that is dating back to the Philippian and the that is considered to be the most significant prehistoric artifact. The Chauvet cave also contains evidence of upper Paleolithic that is important for understanding the origins of our human ancestors, including many large and modern sapiens. Consequently, the Chauvet cave represents an entire component of our understanding of human evolution, both from biological and artistic perspectives. However, evolutionary biology continues to struggle with an empirical understanding of evolutionary origins that also require development of artistic origins. As a result of the family, evolutionary context of the Chauvet cave, I plan to address urban environment that humans are bound far more by natural history than by our cultural history. By integrating these evolutionary origins into our understanding of the outcome of Chauvet cave, I have examined how the survival of the critics might not be the current majority of social dynamics. All humans share the origins of our natural history and the structure of evolution takes us. For more than 2.5 million years since our ancestors first evolved, our history has been shaped by evolutionary forces. Evolution, as Darwin argues, is directional and progresses to ever more complex and adaptive forms of organization. As a result, natural history can be considered simply as history since one level can be defined as a state of evolution and destruction. Although modern humans diverge from our shared common ancestors 300,000 years ago, it still remains unclear how artistic development evolved in our human sapiens. Thus, the Chauvet cave represents a vital insight into our understanding of evolution by examining the evolution of our human ancestors during that period. It is during the Paleolithic age that we encounter the earliest works of our genomic record in the Chauvet cave. The intricate paintings cover the inner walls, showing vigorous outlines of majestic animals across subtly controlled shading that led to both companions to the shrines. These techniques displayed show refinement far removed from any humble beginnings. Unless we are to believe that these paintings came into being in a single stone verse, we must assume that they were preceded by 5 years of slow evolution by which much remains unknown. From Darwin's point of view, 2.5 million years of humans evolving from primate ancestors is sufficient time to create our unique genome. For more than 200,000 years, humans have essentially shared the same genome with our ancestors, and if we are to accept the pictorial representations as a consequence of our Darwinian nature that is bound by the compound of evolution, then we can assume that we are not only looking at ourselves as creatures and gatherers, but also as manifestations of natural selection. Discovered in 1994, the art of the Chauvet cave is by far the earliest evidence of cave paintings, preserving the art of the upper Paleolithic period intact. The artwork in the cave depicts a variety of animals, many of whom are extinct, including the cave bear, woolly rhinoceros, woolly mammoth, bison, and cave lions. Based on radiocarbon dating, the depictions of these animals fall into two groups, one 22,000 years BC and one 26,000 years BC. Even though astounding is that some overlap on painted figures within the cave itself are dated 5,000 years apart. The Paleolithic age is a critical phase in human evolution where two forms of humans were testing their boundaries and perhaps coexisting during the ice age that covered the Earth 3,500 years ago. Scientists have determined that humans did not live inside the cave and used the cave only for painting and possibly ceremonies. However, there is evidence to suggest that interaction between cave dwellers, now extinct, and humans did occur in the cave period during this period. Footprints of cave bears are well documented throughout, as well as scratch marks on the wall. A bear skull has been seemingly placed strategically near the cave entrance, perhaps to signify a spiritual connection to the animals that were being painted. Nevertheless, Chauvet cave depicts no glory of gods or priests. However, moving into the Neolithic age in the beginning of the year's body culture, there are prominent depictions of them. Therefore, we can assume that an evolutionary event occurred between the late Paleolithic and early Neolithic ages that is responsible for the configurations of the world and religion present in the Neolithic art, the absence of the Paleolithic age of Chauvet cave. All the paintings in the Chauvet cave show an uncanny sense of life. One must ask, how did this extraordinary of the diet and that's what we see. So there's no doubt that during the ISIS, something that was aimed at such a thousand men in the ISIS and their blood bags to that. We also know that the hunting techniques of this period were reducing down more pretty wooden shafts that after the spears. As a result, an adept to two of those spatial relationships necessary for hunting these large animals in space of this would have been extremely beneficial for human survival and reproductive fitness. The ability to organize time and space visually, as well as the controls during the space, the most likely essential traits that source would provide these human approaches to expression. Therefore, genes important for hunting and survival might have also been important for its development, the two being inextricably linked together for the future generations. However, it is uncertain if these two traits evolved separately or if artistic proficiency was simply a byproduct of the evolution of heightened spatial acuity associated with the hunting. Scientists today are aware of a cluster of genes that are associated with both heightened athletic perception as well as creativity, and it is possible that these sets of genes are those affiliated with ancestors passed among the New Zealand. Nevertheless, there is evidence to suggest that the acute ability to understand and as well as musical events to attract those movements utilize the same part of the brain for artistic expression. As a consequence, the genes that are associated with greater spatial acuity for hunting are also somehow associated with heightened artistic ability, but it is not unlikely that artists possess genes with greater evolutionary potential and human potential for selection. This is not to say that natural selection will act on artistic expression and hence artists serve to increase their overall fitness in society relative to other individuals, but rather that artistic expression may be an evolutionary artifact of selection and spatial acuity in painting. This logically supports the argument that art done with the highest evolutionary potential is done with the most mature state of creation. From an evolutionary perspective, the ability to hunt these large animals would not only have affected a greater artistic capacity, but more important, it would have affected higher survival and reproduction and hence higher fitness. Evolution by natural selection progresses such that genes that are inherited, that they must be passed on to generations, exist in variable populations where certain traits progress differential survival and reproduction. In the case of Chauvet caves, paleolithic humans would have expressed variability in their ability to hunt and reproduce, and individuals that displayed traits with higher visual acuity and hunting skills would have had greater fitness. Additionally, we know that these genes are vulnerable because they are being continually refined and altered over many successive generations. From the Renaissance to abstract expressionism, where artists adapt to changing social environments that are reflected in their art. The presence of artistic genes, that is, genes responsible for greater spatial acuity, may also incorporate a strong spirituality as well. In order to hunt large animals, often predators, one requires great spatial acuity to survive hunting, which might be integrated in a sense of awe that would take on the spirit of the animals. Arguably, if humans did not understand the spirit of the animals, encompassing the animal's perception of energy, humans are clearly the ancestors of survival and reproduce. This spiritual presence is highly visible in the animals depicted in the caves. Many lionesses are shown resisting acts of labor, and the imagery of fertility is prominent with the painting of a bison fused with a female human form. It is clear that there is a unity between man and the animal in the Chauvet cave, and it is important that we look at these evidence as a fusion of artist and sculptor for the man and the animal. When we are looking at the Chauvet cave, we are also observing humans who tend to resemble the space first, and as a result, there is a strong connection that we, as observers, are witnessing that also speaks to the tremendous spiritual value of this art. Nevertheless, the spiritual nature of cave painting is not only apparent in Chauvet cave, but also extends to Lascaux. Anthropologists suggest that these cave paintings were produced as part of a magic ritual to ensure successful hunt. For the men in the middle of the caves, there was no clear distinction between image and reality. By making a controlled animal, they meant to bring the animal itself within their heads and in cutting the image rather than depicting any familiar incident with respect to that movement's mere reputation. The walls of the Chauvet cave include many territory including mines, campers, bears, owls, and coyotes. The departure from depicting any animals of that name suggests an evolution for the artist that might have perspective the ecological environment of the village. Because many of the animals depicted in the Chauvet cave are not extinct, some argue that this departure from strictly caging animals of that name might have been a recognition of the scarcity of these animals in a climate that is already driving many animal extinctions. However, experts seem to agree that the Chauvet cave is not evidence for human-induced species extinction, because combat predators during the ice age, as well as disease, are likely responsible for the extinction. Even so, it is still extraordinary that the role of the humans of Chauvet cave seem to be aware of their impact on the animals in the country, as reflected in their art. In order to better understand the implications of evolutionary natural selection, one must distinguish the theories and that of social Darwinism. Social Darwinism argues that the fittest individuals should survive and flourish in society, while the weaker ones should be allowed to die. This theory is expounded by Herbert Spencer, but is testing to decide that the manipulation of Darwin's theory of natural selection to support Herbert's own ethical beliefs. The concept of adaptation provided by Darwin allows Herbert to claim that the rich and powerful were better adapted to the social and economic climate of the time. For Herbert, the concept of natural selection provided the Darwin to support the view that the strong should thrive and be respected to be. However, evolution by natural selection does not respond differently to the social climate, race, or ethnicity, which is fundamentally determined by the genetic basis. In fact, survival of the fittest is claimed by Spencer and not Darwin, although Darwin did not use it to briefly indicate this principle of preservation or survival of the fittest as part of natural selection. Therefore, given the evidence for the evolutionary origin of artistic development in the Chauvet cave and paleolithic humans, survival of the fittest may not be a dependent point of order for certain Darwinism. As has been shown in other past argues, the best hunters may have had the concentration of genetic predictions to the hardest for non-hunters. In this sense, it is important to distinguish the evolution of commercial hunters from that of the animals. In the context of social evolution, where emphasis is placed on the ability of the ruling class to impose its full authority on others, the development of warriors is significant. With the advent of agriculture, around 13,000 years ago, humans started to colonize, and this colonization is believed to have facilitated hunters becoming warriors, that is, the hunters of men. Warriors possess the same tools that hunters themselves, but over 2.5 million years, they have not hunted men because hunting other humans before colonization and large populations that have likely resulted from extinction. It is logical to assume that during the Paleolithic age, around the time of the Chauvet cave paintings, there was a very high value placed on human life because of the inability to colonize and the necessity to ensure genomic conservation in future generations. There was not a habit of hunting men, nor was it a value from what we can see in the art of the cave, at least from the ancient supremacist stations. Therefore, hunting and gathering that improves human survival came from their fitness has had a long genetic history, whereas in the age of agriculture and the advent of colonization and war, these skills likely applied to culture and social evolution. In many ways, the paintings of Chauvet cave represent the beginning of the modern human's artistic development. As evidenced in these paintings, humans need to adapt to the landscape and to other animals in order to survive. Being able to communicate and transmit information that's more effective than language, as well as to inscribe this memory for the future, is extremely important for our survival as a species. With the development of configuration of animals, artistic expression is becoming an effective method of communication between humans and the future in order to evoke the past. It is clear that natural history values ongoing cultural history since we are product of our evolutionary past and our ancestors whose genome we can refer to. Nevertheless, although there is considerable evidence to suggest that the evolutionary origin of artistic development is associated with traits considered vital for hunting, that is, heightened vision and hearing, this association still remains unclear. Artistic development could be an evolutionary byproduct of natural selection and visual acuity in hunting, genetically linked by a targeted selection itself, or simply an evolutionary artifact that is regardless, it is evident that the genes associated with autistic expression autism vary in the human population and could have ensured greater fitness and compatibility to survive the genes. Therefore, these genes are subject to evolution by natural selection. As a consequence, artists are particularly relevant in adapting their own integrated perceptions of human values in relation to empirical reality, just as empirical reality itself values their environment.
I could begin by picking up some of the threads of what David said in this very interesting approach. And I think the central section he had where he was very careful to liberate the sort of ideas he was brought to from crude ideas of social Darwinism and survival. I thought it was a very valuable interpolation. Clearly, that's not a model that many groups don't see really. That's not a model that we want to, that we want to go back to. And as David implied, the whole concept of the survival of the fittest has always had its own sort of logical track or its logical circularity, because the sort of fitness that we're defining turns out to be rather circular, because we just define it by its survival, perhaps. So we go round and round in circles. It's saying it can show up much less than it appears to be saying at the beginning. And this raises in particular the question of the traits that we are identifying as crucial here in the paper, and in Jeffrey's thinking, which informs it to some extent here, we're isolating the fitness for purpose, as it were, of the hunter, because that is so basic to survival in the agricultural system. We're also counting that with the fitness, if it's the right term to apply here, of the artist in the developing artistic capacities. And as has been said, it may be that the sort of capacities that we identify here may be more interchangeable, they may imply different sorts of ability to adapt to it. I think this insight indeed could be widened beyond those two particular sorts of capacities that we're quite understanding and focused on. There's been recent work, I think, that has looked at athletic capabilities, has measured them in ways that get quite away from an old, arid, intellectualized concept of an IQ or intelligence quotient that was measured just by doing IQ tests, and that was supposed to be some sort of proxy for general intelligence. The recent work, I gather, has shown that athletic capacities can be measured and shown to correlate in sometimes surprising ways with other measures of intelligence. So that's one way of broadening the concepts of what fitness is and what we're measuring here and what we're looking at. It seems to me to be an interesting parallel. Another example that comes to mind would be the increasing use of the term these days, emotional intelligence, which is a fairly recent coinage, isn't it? I don't know if it's been quite recent. But suggesting that the old concept of what it were IQ intelligence is a very varied and narrow and a definition of the concept which is incapable of grasping the fullness of the human personality with a range of different sorts of capacities which we might be concerned with here. So, in offering these suggestions, I'm really concerned with corroborating, agreeing with what David's been putting forward and the spirit in which Jeffrey also developed his ideas, suggesting that perhaps it fits, that it's not only true, but it fits within a body of wider truth as we understand the nature of human capacity in general. I don't have a formal thesis to advance here. I just offer these as my own personal responses.
Thank you. Oh, yes. I very much enjoyed your paper. Can I just ask as a sceptical question, what kind of people do you think produce these paintings in the Chauvet, and do you think that they consider themselves to be artists?
So, yeah, the idea of self-awareness and the effect of that, to begin to size, but
So whether that sort of opens things up, whether there's a much larger group of people that are producing the images, or a very select group, I think it's interesting. It's probably unanswerable as well.
You bet. That I was trying to express before, because in a naive way, we could take James's question, did he consider himself an artist, or she considered herself an artist, whoever it was who produced these paintings. Doesn't this have a hidden implication that would surely be false about a sort of division of labour, as though we could send someone to interview these people in the cave and say, are you a hunter-gatherer then? Yes, I'm the hunter-gatherer, but my brother over there, he's an artist. You can see he's at work. Whereas all these people, consistent with the Darwinist model that we're looking at, are pitted in a terrible daily struggle for survival, aren't they? which may imply, of course, that there are periods of the year when they had more free time because there was, you know, the natural rhythms of that sort of society at the time. Of course, I'm caricaturing what James is asking there, but it's important, I think, not to have that image in our mind as though the artist as such is already a special sort of human condition or category, as it seems to me.
Has anyone done a stylistic analysis of these to know how many different words that you can really be listening to? Has anyone ever looked at them and said, oh, this is almost what happened to 25 different people? Or, I mean, there are two different periods.
Then we have Altamira, and it's very similar, and that probably is quite a distance to them in terms of the time or the generations that might move for it from them, you know, and lodge themselves. The other thing that's really interesting is how Eurocentric the art is. This is something that fascinates me to no end, that the same lines in the Chauvet case appear in Michelangelo and this I can't get over, because in other cultures from that particular period of time, there is not that line. And it does at least raise the concept of speculation that may be Dawson's idea of memes, but also because of the locality. But this is certainly the lifelines in those caves are the same lifelines that, you know, when I was an art student, we were duplicating in my life, you know, and not copying them, duplicating. This is a different thing altogether. So I found that is a really, really interesting set of possibilities, but only increases the depth of understanding of these genetic origins. And I do want to say something else about David and how serendipitous it is that we have found a scientist, a future, maybe great scientist, with art perception. And he brings that to the table, and that is one of the most amazing things I think. It was just like we threw out something to the world over the internet. David responded to it, and we had no idea. All of this has come together extraordinarily well, because he becomes proof that the empirical mind also can be associated with the artistic mind. That's something that we need to be seeking. So this is something that I'm really gratified that this is happening.
Getting back to the interview that you talked about, we're interviewing the guy in the cave. So here's the way I think. I think that you'd say, oh, are you a hunter-gatherer? And the father would say, well, I am, but my brother over there, he's doing the painting. He's our historian, and that's been handed down just as our grandfather was. I think I got it. I think I got Jethro Richmond to teach me a thing I understand.
Called providing a perception of sort of whole human lives and having different characteristics that human beings need to get by and that's the problem or something else. I also think there's a similar kind of broadness in generosity and contribution into the concept of intelligence and heritability. In the sense that this is an ongoing dispute in the American cultural tradition, sociobiology, the various attempts to link up our understanding of genetics, which is always developing itself, and our understanding of culture and society. And that's inheritance, the term didn't come from evolutionary science, it actually came, it came from physical inheritance of property and land and personal goods. And it's sort of a back analogy that anybody's involved in science, that there's something kind of pre-conscious, something imminent, something physical that is being inherited. And I would just say when we ever come, whenever we come across a phenomenon that we see that occurs over time, it, to me at least, is an open question of what kind of inheritance is it. In the sense that there's, So when I hear that these lions that we see in the Chauvet caves have been inherited by my evolution, that could mean any number of different things. Right? There are many causal pathways that could bring a certain technique and a certain kind of vision and perception or a certain way of doing something down hundreds of thousands or even million years. It could be inheritance in this deep biological sense, and then scientists debate how long does it take for something really to be present as a genetic phenomenon, or it could be just an incredibly resilient and impressive process of cultural exchange from parent to child and from the hardest to apprentice. And I'm not, in it. Well, that's a really interesting point. This is a debate that's been going on for thousands of years among scientists, lawyers, but it goes all the way back to the beginning of human society. And I would say that the kind of paradigmatic answer today, what legal history is suggesting generally, is that generally the idea of a normal person, a reasonable man, these sorts of standards are created by ingenious human societies. And obviously, this description of agency is difficult
who was doing the construction of these ideas. But it's quite clear when you look at the historical scope, the meaning of reasonableness, the meaning of normal, the meaning of lawful, the meaning of sin, the meaning of crime, the meaning of excellence, all of these things change constantly. So, I mean, so from that perspective, I would say that there's more change than there is continuity. That said, there are patterns. You know, the fact that there always are norms, right, is a constant. The nature of the norms change. But the fact that humans are creatures that create norms, that seems to be quite continuous. And there you might hopefully look further and further back. Why is it that humans are norm creating creatures? You know, so in that sense, there's tremendous continuity.
Understandings of the Darwinian, the way that the genome has developed in terms of thinking, is the concept of clusters of genes is very, very important. So what you deal with is, if we deal, say, with conscience and the concept that might be inherited, we deal with a whole continuum. It's the number of genes that might be expressed. This is built into to Darwin. In order to have the variations that should the environment change radically, these clusters of genes are available for humans to keep surviving on. So the consequence is you can't point to a cluster of genes and say, bang, there's the characteristic of this computer. We can plug it together this way, but what we can do is point towards the evidence of this cluster, this continuum. And conscience is one of those things that reappears in human history over and over and over again. So it isn't just norms. It's another set of characteristics. The concept of the spiritual is in every society that way. And so the concept of the spiritual can be envisioned as a continuum. But it's the continuum idea that's the most important aspect of this kind of thinking. And that is definitely, and so that you can see the error of any type of eugenics is that you're going to try and eliminate the continuum, which is absolutely insane. There's a wonderful essay by Thomas Huxley. I'm not doing that. I'm not going down that road because of how you will end up with the garden, with such weak creatures that have had no proof of existence, have had no. The warnings are out there. He was Darwin's bulldog, so you can see how it's very difficult to go down a Spencerian road when his bulldog is saying, don't go down this road. So when we look at it that way, the expression of the gene is like in a continuum. So I think that there are blocks of continuums that you can see that the norms that we would create from those blocks of continuums would vary from culture to culture, and whatever the exigency is perceived to be at the given time. So, that might go on for 300 years or 500 years until it becomes a cultural one. The other aspect of it is what's so interesting about the concept of mimetics is that it's suggested really strongly in The Selfish Gene by Dobbins in 1976, and then it disappears from all of these books up until the God delusion. I don't know whether he's beginning to take it seriously or he's becoming such a poop that he can make up anything now. And he's become a television personality. And he'll go anywhere, right? But that's really interesting because his concept is the long-term transfer, the long-term social transfer of certain things. And that part from the cave to Michelangelo and Leonardo, I don't really see that as genetic. I think it opens up the real possibilities of mimetics in operation over a very long period of time. Very long.
What is
There's a number of ways that
I don't think there's not a clear answer to that because it's always in progress. To what extent do the genes determine this or that? I mean, it's the old traditional nature of the diabetes argument from the 1980s. Well, we certainly have more science, as David has shown us today. But, as a cultural historian, I still look at both. However, I mean, I have to look and see that line. And I think that, there's the Madonna cartoon, the National Gallery of Women, the United States, and it's a sacred woman. So, but James and Jimmy, and so on.
I worry when it seems you see that discipline seems to be able to explain about almost every behavior and suggest that everything that we do as humans is a certain purpose, some biological purpose. And it may be true about that, but why worry if we reduce artistic expression, aesthetic experience to some biological function? I don't see when you get pleasure from seeing the beautiful sunrise. I don't see the natural I don't see what the biological purpose of that is. Maybe it's just about being young and very, very confident in highly developed brains. Which generate a behavior that perhaps isn't entirely about survival. It's about something more than survival.
There's two or three parts to this. The first part is the advent of empiricism itself as a philosophy, trying to predict, after Leibniz, the clockwork universe, trying to predict the outcomes. Now, what we're talking about here is not predicting the outcomes, rather, only the inputs, but not the outcomes. And so, it's fantastic that the concept of gene. In describing whether a gene is switched on, scientists tend to use this, I've read, switched on, but what they're really saying is expressed. And I think it's really interesting to say how a gene is expressed, but not the outcome of that. The whole concept of Darwin is that you don't predict the outcome of the situation. You actually have the potential of surviving the outcome of the situation. And that's the part that I wanted to make.
Could I add to that then? Would it be possible to say that our genetic endowment is a necessary but not a sufficient condition? That it has to be there, in that sense, it's essential, but equally, it is not predictive of a unique outcome in this way. Would that be
that's the artistic expression.
Yes.
You know, when I go into a piece, I don't predict the outcome. I can't predict the outcome, but I know what the inputs are. And so there's a knowledge of the inputs, both in terms of what I've produced already, as well as this other sense of what the inputs might be from the inputs. So that's really important, because the concept of the clockwork universe is the reason why artists became involved, as I understand it. That both in philosophy, even got worse, it got down to the mathematical part. And in Baumgarten, I talk about it, not because I know, it's because of Peter Hans Rath moves it to be on that, so that the information that is contained in our perception can be contained as something beyond the empirical argument. He didn't state that explicitly, but he did include that in the paper.
Thank you. I was astonished that these others came to him to this
35 you mean us? Did I leave out from them to us?
And us.
Oh, yeah, 15,000 years.
15,000 years of history.
But how about to Michelangelo? How about the 35,000?
One question I have, but it's not easy. Where did it start? Is it the second of the Greek stone? Did it disappear somewhere? Did it disappear
somewhere? The role of the artist changed in civilization. When civilization came along, the artist began to be the first recorders of history and started to work for the system itself. So that, I mean, if you come up to either Mesopotamia or to Egypt, you'll start to see the pictographic job of the artist, and the line disappears simply because it becomes stylized in almost the language itself. I'm trying to spell out, you know, being very, very, very direct and very literal. If you look at the Egyptian work, it becomes very static. And this happened, and that happened. And then you can just see how that comes down from the Quranic declarations of who they are, and what's predictable. And that's the other aspect. We can't lose is the concept of predictability. And attempting to know the outcome, and claims to know the outcome, which is essentially the basis of civilization and agriculture. The strength of at least, if not knowing, at least pretending to know the outcome. So you end up with a priesthood, you end up with the kind of controls that go to make sure that that's there. And the artists have a job. If you're born with the ability for mimesis, in order to be able to draw something, out goes the lifeline and in comes the rigid passed down to generation to generation to generation, the history of it. And that's why I have a great deal of trouble with so-called primitive art, you know, on societies that actually use their visual material, pre-literate societies that pass through their visual material. It's very important to that society that those ideas remain intact. So the freedom of the artist is really restricted at that particular point to assuring that what's passed on from generation to generation is consistent. So I'm sure that this is very true of totem poles and how we may look at them as a work of art, but in fact, there's no real freedom for the artist at all. So it's, no, not past the caves. The caves are pre-agriculture. That's the whole argument.
Well, okay.
See, once you have agriculture, you have a central. The one key to agriculture, from my point of view, is the granary. It's the center of everybody's life or death, because on one hand, you have grain, on the other hand, you have seed. Okay, in times of plenty, everybody eats. But what happens in the time when there's a long period of drought? If you eat the seed, the village dies, and the society and the civilization dies. So it's at that particular point that the granary becomes critical on how a person would give up their ability towards the decision-making as to whether or not their children are going to die or not. And so the amount of allocation that comes with rationing begins the idea of the rigidity of how that society is going to carry on. And so if you want to look at the key institution to agriculture that changes everything is the grain, because it is present tense and it is future tense of that ability. And as you divide those things out, then the decisions, all the decisions are made not on based on freedom and not on the based on the freedom of the artist. The artist, then his job becomes to tell the story of that particular tribe and justify that civilization's future. And as you start to look at that, then there becomes a very rigid storytelling at that particular point. Because if you lose the rigidity of that, then you will lose the fundamental institutions. So the fundamental institutions have to be protected by whom? Oh, the hunters have a job. You know, we're going to protect that granary. And so now you have a defensive posture. You have a priesthood which has the responsibility, the moral responsibility, to make the decisions. And people will give up that moral responsibility in that exercise to that priesthood because they can't make up a decision. They can't make the decision who lives and dies. So in times of plenty, everybody's doing great. Why people stayed in this civilization the way that I see it is they could actually multiply. So in the long run, in the long term of agriculture, more people survive and more offspring survive, so this is the Darwinian explanation for it, than could do in the wild. But the freedom was not. And the freedom for the artist, well, he had a job to do. You wonder where the line went. And it doesn't return until the freedom of the Renaissance. And the freedom of the Renaissance, it returns. Thank you.